India Charts publishes Nifty Daily, daily video updates, the weekly Elliott Wave Outlook, and the Long Shot Report, covering all asset classes.
Yesterday, I promised I would look into the global market setup, especially to get an insight as to why we should or shouldn't expect a major market meltdown. Because whenever that happens, especially when it starts from the US, definitely it ends up affecting the rest of the world that we've seen over and over again. But is there a setup? Because each and every market sometimes can be different. And does the whole world have a setup where it looks like, you know, it's all going to fall apart? And so that is where you get your confidence when you do a proper worldwide analysis and not just looking at one market or the other or some kind of narrative that, you know, things are going to fall apart, but it has to be visible everywhere. So what have various other world markets been going through? And we'll try to scan through all of that. What you're seeing on my screen is a very quick snapshot of what we've all gotten used to tracking, which is the dollar index here on the right hand side, where I've marked an ending pattern into the top of wave 2 and expecting wave 3 down to start. So we have an initial minor wave 1 and 2, which yesterday almost did a double top, and it's down from there today. So that's one, of course, of the macro factors that we all watch. And on the left hand side here, you see silver, which is doing the opposite. And this is silver MCX. So it's actually rallied, pull back 61% and starting to move up again from here. So these are two that have been covering regularly. Silver, I've just written about the MCX price levels on my website, but what we've been writing about for the last couple of days has been a lot of the world market. So here you're looking at a chart of the DAX. Okay, so the DAX, which is the German index, has been an important one to really gauge what's going on, and we've marked it as a fourth wave correction inside this rising channel from the wave to low. So if you take the highs and we do a reverse channel, that's exactly where prices stopped and then they broke out of this falling channel. In fact, sort of almost surpassed this previous high of the third wave. So I would think that the fifth wave up has started, will head back to the top end of the channel. So this is not a setup for a major sell-off. And note, all of this is within a third wave of larger degree, because what we are really looking at is down here, you see a small little 2 written, which means we've completed wave 2, and this is 1, 2, 3, 4 of the third wave of a larger degree. So we still are looking at a fifth wave long term to really complete before, you know, something can end at a bigger scale. So we are still at the end of the third within that. So that's how you really look at, you know, each of these markets. So what you can get, so apart from, okay, you don't have the long term setup, then yes, we can worry about whether you have a near term setup for a good correction like we saw here in wave 2. Will there be a fourth? But that can only be after 5 waves complete. So that's what we are focused on. Now let me move to, say, Japan, right? So the Nikkei index here, if I just click on it, can zoom, and moment I do that, you can actually see a very similar setup happening in Japan, with one difference that it's not already into a third, it's completed the third wave from the March 2020 lows, and after that gone into a complex correction, which is inside this downward channel. We believe it's almost complete because you gapped up here, forming an island reversal, you know, at the fag end, and have started to go up. So probably the fifth wave has started now finally in the last couple of days, after all the volatility that we've really seen around the Japanese index. So essentially, when you log into the India Charts website and you move around, when you go to the right hand side, you'll see here it says world markets. And when we click on world markets, you actually end up opening this page, which has all the global indices covered from time to time. Now, some of the pages I do make freely available. Like last week, all the global updates were free for a while. And then it is some other section that goes free for a while, and then another section. So this is what we keep doing on a rotational basis, just to, you know, allow people to get through what we are trying to say on different markets. So you may have seen some of these updates already if you're following on social media. And this is the Russell 2000, which we covered, has also completed a fourth wave and has been attempting to start wave 5. We saw the initial 1 and 2, which we do think is an impulse, and now probably starting a 3. You know, so each of these waves subdivided, if you look at wave 1, we saw 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Within wave 3, we can see 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And then the fourth wave, where again, we're going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 is how I see it. So each one will see full subdivisions. And till this small cap index for the US is not done with, I guess we are not inside a major top. So what really confuses a lot of people is when they look at different indices in the US, you end up getting intermarket divergences. And here what you're looking at is on top the Dow Jones Industrials, and at the bottom you're looking at the Dow Jones Transports. Now both of them seem to have peaked around here, which is, let me just move this down a little bit so we'll see the date as well. So this is at around the 10th of May 2021. Okay, so 10th of May we've seen this top, and from there both have been declining, and then you have this intermarket divergence. See, this is what people miss, where a new low in the Dow Transports has not been confirmed by a new low in the Dow Jones Industrials. This is a bullish signal, this is a bullish divergence, because we are looking at the lows and not the highs, and one market has turned up and the other is lagging behind. Now, so this has already done 1, 2 and started 3, whereas the Transports is just starting its initial one of a first wave of the next move up, and the Transports on a wider degree is actually at the bottom end of its, you know, rising channel. If I take the channel for this entire time period, you know, so it would be sort of attempting to, you know, hit the lower end and, you know, start bottoming out and move ahead. May have slightly broken the lower end as well if I actually extend this channel. So that's where when you get a, you know, mild break, you can sometimes get confused about the overall structure, but if you actually fit this whole thing in, you will find that somewhere you have channel support, you know, coming in. So we actually like the idea that it's, you know, only a mild break, and this divergence I think was more important. So why do these divergences happen? They happen because you have some level of rotation going on, which is, you know, money moves into some assets first and then others later on. And so it appears like either a lead lag or you'll see a complete inverse relationship in the short term. So this is even more apparent with the tech index, right? So if I put up the Nasdaq 100, what you'll find is that these two indices have sort of inversely related with each other. So I'll try to put them on the same timeline, you know, so that they are more comparable there. So sort of when we are looking at, say, this top, okay. So when this top occurred down here, we are actually up here. Okay, in the Nasdaq. So the Nasdaq made its highest point once over here, got a very deep correction compared to the Dow Jones, and then the Dow Jones made a higher high which was not confirmed by the Nasdaq. Now at that time you can end up thinking that this is sort of a negative divergence, but it was not, because you had a very clear impulse on the Dow, which means the Dow is clear about going higher. The Nasdaq underperformed till this time period. Okay, this is exactly where you topped around the 10th of May, and where are we on the 10th of May? We are down here. So in the next few days, you see the Nasdaq bottoming out and starting to rally. And this is the time period where the Dow actually went down. So you have this, you know, asset allocation shift happening between these two sectors, which is the industrials and the tech. And then people will end up looking either, oh, tech is down, so the market's going to fall, but then the industrials are up. And then the industrials are down, they'll say the market's going to fall, but the tech is up. When actually all they are doing is very short-term divergences, which are driven by either changes in, you know, the bond market or changes in the dollar, which affect, you know, near-term thinking on their profitability cycles. But it's nothing more than asset allocation happening with fund managers shifting money from one sector to the other. So if you even move to something like the utilities, right, the DJU, you'll actually find it underperforming for long periods of time relative to the underlying index. But that doesn't mean that, you know, the whole market's falling apart. So what you actually need to do is a wave count on both of them separately. And each one may complete their final fifth waves at a different point of time. But the real question is, has any of these markets completed wave 5, which is what I've tried to show in the first two charts around the world, that you've really not done so. So even though you had this top here, wave 1, you had the top here, wave 1, much before on the utilities. Utilities went into a correction, the industrials corrected later on, then the utilities went up. So you sort of see an inverse relationship between these two. But eventually both are moving higher, you know, so it's just that one is moving higher, the other is, you know, sort of slightly slower or underperforming, and then when the other is pulling back, the other is gaining, and so on and so forth. But now in the very short term, after this initial leg up, I think this is where the divergence sort of ends here at this bottom, and then just like in the transports, I think we are seeing the industrials lead, the utilities are only picking up now. Will they continue to do so? If the industrials still rally is a big question mark. We don't know. We'll have to monitor that, because on and off we've seen inversion happen. But after a lag, we've also seen the two move up together at times, like they did over here in the months of March and April, right? So it's not always that they're completely inversely related. Now, here's another intermarket relationship that people don't always get, which is bond yields are more directly correlated to US banking stocks than you would think otherwise. So when you're actually seeing yields, okay, so what you're seeing on the top end of the chart, the 10-year yield, what you're seeing at the bottom end of the chart, the US bank index, okay, so it's the Dow Jones bank index. And you can see both of them falling together right into these lows. Then of course one of them may bounce a little earlier than the other, which is fine, which is an intermarket divergence and late part of a move. But here, as yields remain flattish downish, so did the bank index remain with pretty much flattish downish. Okay, and when you actually got this breakout, okay, so let's presume this is the breakout point from where yields started to rise. And of course the media starts recognizing it only late here. I think I started hearing it only in Jan that yields are rising. But what it really meant is that your bank stocks or the US bank stocks actually did well during this entire time period. And only when you're seeing them in late stages of this move, you're seeing the peaking cycle in yields, and now yields are dropping and you have the bank index also weakening somewhat, you know. So even today, while US indices appear up, yields are a bit down, and the bank index is also a bit down. So this is a kind of relationship people can quickly get past, because the media will keep telling you that rising yields are bad, but yields are only following the economy. If you get an inflationary cycle, yields are going to lag and rise behind it, and so they are not the cause, they are just the effect of what is going on. And at a time when, you know, you'll be ready for a risk off trade, then definitely yields will start falling again, which is what we saw in the last couple of months. So how about France? Now within, we've looked at Germany. So within Europe, France, very similar wave count. We completed or are completing the fourth of a third wave, and we still have the fifth wave of the third pending, you know, so we still have that upside incomplete before we can actually say that, you know, we've completed an advance which needs to again go into a longer corrective phase. Now, of all the emerging markets, Brazil is an interesting one and probably one of the leaders, because it was the first to actually break out of its 2010 to 2018 downward channel or trading range that it was stuck in when the dollar was in a bullish trend. And the moment the dollar went into a bearish trend for the first time in 2018, Brazil really broke out to new all-time highs. So that's been the interesting chart. And through the panic of 2021, it essentially ended up making a second wave and then has rallied since there in a first, which I've marked here as 1, 2, and we are still inside the third, you know, multiple subdivisions as you can see here, and very slow move from the bottom end of this channel heading higher. But essentially we can say it's far from complete. I've put the top end of the channel close to around 1,55,000 for the index. So long way to really go, and no signs here that, you know, you've really ended anything longer term. How about Australia's daily chart? You know, from the lows of March 2020, we get an initial impulse, 1, 2, then again we get another one completing and further subdividing, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So this last 5-way would also complete only a third inside the third and should have way to go. So what has happened in many of these markets, as we are seeing, is many of them either completed fourth waves, are in a fourth wave, or are just about starting a fifth wave, and which is why you're seeing this rotational volatility among, you know, global indices. So what you're watching here is the Taiwan index did something very similar. The first and second did the third, came back to the bottom end of the channel. I initially thought maybe that will be more long winding if this fall is 5 waves, but eventually it's taken out this high. So that's no more the case. And we are in a slowly advancing fifth wave already. So some markets are already started, some are starting, some are down there. And once they're all in that fifth wave of this current third or whatever degree of structure they are forming, that's when probably, you know, they would align again for another correction. But right now, it still looks like they're all just starting something afresh, each one at a time, some of them slower than others, and which is where all the confusion comes from, is the rotation when we see between these sector, country-specific movements. So not very, very far from what we would end up seeing on the Nifty. Even if I go down to a daily chart, the triangular structure that we see here is typical of fourth wave. So we may have completed some degree of a third and fourth wave at this point of time and started a fifth wave inside of that, And once you identify that's probably the, you know, best case scenario, then you're able to get a better judgment of, you know, what is really happening. Because we may have just started a fifth wave, again, just like in many other markets. It's very early to say that this is the end of fifth, because the size of the previous rallies is pretty large. Of course, you can get truncated moves. But when so many markets are doing something, then to really say that something is truncated is a tough spot. I think the easy answer will come moment you surpass this bunch of highs that you got around 15,930. For the time being, what I marked this as probably the first and second of the fifth, given the extension, longer rallies that we've seen in the early waves as well. And I would then expect this move to really, you know, continue. And, you know, further subdivide into third, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at a logic degree. And that confirmation will come once we surpass this this entire range above 15,915 to be the exact high. Or if you take the trend line of these highs, it will be at around 15,930. And once we close above that, then it should be signaled that a further extension in the fifth wave has already started. The main concern that people have had has essentially been the slowness of this rally, because it's taken as long as, you know, some of the previous moves. Some of the previous moves were far more steeper, as you can see here, and they were not as slow as this one, which has taken several weeks. And the other thing has been, and that's my watch point actually, which is this declining volume. So declining volumes are not good, but declining volumes are also normal during a consolidation. So if this is a normal wave to consolidation, then great, you have falling volumes. But when you break out and you start a fresh move, you must see volume expansion. If that is missing, then definitely it's an issue. But, you know, so which means volume is supposed to expand with the trend, which is when prices are rising, volume should expand. When prices are consolidating, volumes decline, that's normal. But if the opposite happens, then that becomes an early warning sign that, you know, the trend is about to fail or reverse. And so far, people watching these volumes may look at it, oh, it's a sign of a topping process here, and I can argue it's a sign of a consolidation. But definitely, if you break out to new highs without volumes, then that would be a concern.
Nothing in this podcast is investment advice. Views on financial markets are in good faith to expand your understanding of how markets work. Please consult a registered financial advisor for the same.